Greetings once again. Welcome to our show, The Silence of Our Friends. I'm George M. Matthews II. It's a privilege and an honor to be with you tonight. But listen, you can do me a huge favor if you would be so kind as to accommodate. Stop what you're doing now, and let's try to get as many people logged on with us presently as we possibly can. You could do this in a couple of ways. One, if you're on Facebook, please take the time to press the share icon. That will, in the way things function, that will share our show with all of your Facebook friends. If, again, you believe it's meritorious, if you believe our content in the past has been worthy of your sharing, if you believe it's worthwhile, if you believe it'll make a difference, press that share icon. I can't tell you how important that is. And then any interaction that you will share with us tonight, thumbs up, emojis, comments, of course, sharing, all of that is important to get the algorithms to share the page and to share our show with as many people as possible. This is, again, an introduction for all of us to Cyberonics 101. Interaction is key, so please help us with that. If you're over on the Facebook side of the world, please copy the link. You can share it with any of your friends or persons that you think will benefit from hearing about Black bronze and Black people, Black bronze and brown people in these yet to be United States. I believe we have a lot to say, and certainly tonight is no exception. We've said a lot for 6-7 months, and tonight will be no difference. So please, if you're on YouTube, it's very important that you subscribe to the channels. It costs you nothing, but again, that is the key interaction that makes everything work. So please, if you're viewing there, stop by our ministry page. You can simply type in my name. You'll see our ministry page come up. Over 500 videos, I believe, are out there. If you will subscribe to that particular channel, I think it's in the name under the name of New Life Interfaith Ministries. But if you'll type my name, everything should come up. And then certainly for The Silence of Our Friends, make sure you have subscribed to the channel. Then press the notification icon. Generally, it's associated with the right of the screen, and that will ensure that each time we go live, you will not miss an episode. And tonight, I believe we have something for you that is going to be good. Again, thank you for sharing your time with us. It is important. As a people, we have a lot of ground to cover. Our show topic tonight is When Dogs Do Not Bark. This is our fourth episode. There's a lot more to these non-barking dogs. So When Dogs Do Not Bark, episode 4, racism. Our topic tonight is a system. So the subject, When Dogs Do Not Bark, episode 4, and then racism as a system. Racism is a system. I'll get it right in a moment. Our premise again, when the church of the Lord Jesus Christ has never properly described or shown a prototype of how racism should be handled. You know, those who are born again, those who are called out of darkness into his marvelous light, and then we hide from societal issues, then we hide from things that could make a difference in the lives of people. After all, it was slave masters who, first of all, purchased, owned slaves as chattel, C-H-A-T-T-E-L, as chattel, and treated them harshly by whippings, beatings, scourgings, even hangings, lynchings, if you will, violating the family, the female in the family, and then castigating, if you will, the male in the family. These were same people who were on Sunday mornings assembled in a church hearing the word of God. Allegedly hearing the word of God. How could they? So when the church is off kilter, when the model is not there, then society wanes, society dips, and society has its ailments when the church is sick and afflicted. And again, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ and society have never correctly dealt with the issue of white supremacy in America, which has not prevented the world system from expunging itself from this ugly demon of racism. The church has withheld the intended light through which a correct antidote should have been modeled. Jesus gave these two metaphors. He said, you are, in St. Matthew chapter 5, the church, called out ones, people who were born again, people who love Jesus. Jesus said of those people and of that retinue, you are the light of the world, not of the church. We've been lighting the church until the church is overly lit, overly lighted and having problems. But Jesus said, you're the light of the world and the salt of the earth. And when the salt has lost its flavor, its ability to enhance or at least influence, it's good for nothing but to be cast out and trodden under the feet of men. And he said of light that no man takes a candle and hides it under a bushel, but he puts it on a candlestick so that all that are in the house, all that are in a society can be benefited from the light thereof. Dr. King makes a statement. We're here each Monday from 6:30 p.m. until 7:30 roughly. We have a little bit of a late start tonight as things go electronically. Dr. M.L. King makes the statement, what will be remembered in the end will not be the words of our enemies. You know, we put a lot of stock on what our enemies say about us, but he makes a very profound statement in my mind. What will be remembered in the end will not be the words of our enemies, but here it is, wait for it, the silence of our friends, the silence of our friends. He makes another statement. There's nothing in the world more dangerous than sincere ignorance, those who are sincere but yet ignorant. And the other category, obviously, are the conscientiously stupid. At the end of the day, no matter how many books they've read, how the number of the kind of exposure they've had, the number of seminars they have attended, the levels of enlightenment makes no matter, because at the end of the day, because of their consciousness, because of the seeds that have implanted in them, they're still stupid. And on the other side of the spectrum, of course, you have people who are sincere but ignorant. They mean well. In many instances, they're found in churches. They love Jesus. They're lovers of Jesus. But again, there's something, there's a mental block somewhere in their way of thinking as far as the subject of equality between the races is concerned. Truth spoken, modeled, and embraced again by spiritual leaders and leaders in general, leadership in general, leaders in the home, leaders in the workplace, political leaders. It was designed to produce safety. People feel safe. People feel comfortable. People feel secured when leaders model, again, truth. They support and embrace veracity, truthfulness, and integrity. Some people would say to me, George Matthews, you are a minister, and so you should just mind your own business. As if I haven't said enough already in prior episodes and then in the early part of our show tonight, people would say to me, you should just do church and leave the society to handle its own challenges. After all, the church has enough challenges in and of itself. And to them, I would cite, as I do every week, another biblical reinforcement in terms of what is the mind of God, what is the kingdom of heaven regarding believers. In St. John chapter 17, verse 11, and those of us who are homiletically inclined, those of us who are skilled in terms of message preparation, and sermon building and sermon sharing, if you will, we understand St. John chapter 17 as the cap off of the Last Supper, which began in St. John chapter 13. In St. John chapter 17, this entire chapter is referred to as Jesus's high priestly prayer, as he is returning to his office of the high priest who makes intercession for believers. And Jesus is praying to his Father. And remember, he's closing out the Last Supper, which began in chapter 13. And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world. They're in the world system. And I come to thee, Holy Father, keep them through thine own name, those whom thou hast given me. And here's the key emphasis part of the scripture, that they may be one, as, that's a simile, as we are. So now Jesus is praying that the church should be one, regardless of gender, regardless of ethnicity, regardless of political affiliations, regardless of socioeconomic statuses and identities, regardless of education. The end of the day, Jesus speaks to this issue of societal challenge, and to that he says, I'm praying to the Father that my church should be one or equal, blacks with white, bronze, browns, and blacks with whites, regardless of a white supremacy founded nation. Jesus's prayer was that if anyone in the earth should get it, it should be his church, and we should be one. Now, the church, and again, this is not a message, and nor is it the channel that we only deal with spiritual issues, but it's the channel that we overlay social concerns with spiritual insight. Okay, maybe that's a fair way to apprise or appraise what we're doing. The church, to me, is the axis that keeps things in place in the world. If you can get the axis to tilt, to arc away from its design purpose, then of course the whole thing shifts. I'm told that the earth rotates, and it takes 24 hours for it to rotate from the sun to the moon. And it rotates on an invisible axis, A-X-I-S, and that axis polarization and pulls, scientific pulls, the axis keeps the whole globe steadied, and it keeps it not moving too fast, so you can have the benefits of the cold and then the benefits of the heat at the same time, as an even mix, and then at the same time not moving so slowly that the earth's the sun's rays would burn up any one spot, but just it is an even flow. And the church, in the mind of God, God's people are supposed to be in place so that the balance comes to the world. As things go with the church, as things go with the people of God, so they go with the world or the world system. We're entering into, and again, I don't stand in the office of a prophet, but because of the office in which I stand, prophetic utterances come from time to time. But I will say, we are in a season where people are hearing, they come to hear about Jesus, and they love Jesus, but they're afraid of some of his followers. Now that's crazy, where people love Jesus, but they're afraid of some of his followers, so as to mean that we're in a place where the church now, God's people, the individuals, as well as the institution called the church, has to find a way so as to welcome people that God is bringing into his body by way of the blood of Jesus Christ, but at the same time, cause them not to be afraid of their assimilation and association with the organized church. Now, that's another mouthful, probably for another day. A few moments in Black history. I told you, because this is the month of February, it is the month in which we celebrate Black history, historical achievements, and their effects and impacts on these yet to be United States. That is important to the end that most people, by not knowing the impacts of people of color, black, bronze, and brown people, are led to believe, sometimes intentionally and sometimes because of not knowing, that black, bronze, and brown people are an afterthought. Two, have never made significant contributions, hence they must be lazy, shiftless, and of no value or no count. And this was where this idea of marginalization, devaluing, comes into play. It's in many instances it is intentional. So then, to that intentionality, to a dangerous arc, we must correct the arc. We must tell our own story, share our own narratives, so that people coming behind us really understand that people of of color are significant to this country's process and progress. Otis Boykin's most notable contribution to science was likely the circuit improvements he made to pacemakers after losing his mother to heart failure, a contribution that has saved countless lives since. But this single improvement was among a long list, hear this, of achievements. Boykin had 26 patents in his name and is famed, hear this, for the development of IBM computers, burglar-proof cash registers, chemical air filters, and an electronic resistor used in control of missiles and other devices. Now, you never hear his name associated with the likes of IBM, but the IBM computer was the brainchild, or at least some components of the development of that process, had a black, bronze, or brown hand involved with the process. Let's move on. Another black achiever in this country is goes by the name of Lonnie G. Johnson. Lonnie Johnson. If you ever enjoyed a water gun fight as a child, and this is probably people around born in the late 80s or 90s, well, meet Lonnie Johnson. The man gave us the famous water gun. Here it is, the Super Soaker. Super Soaker 1, Super Soaker Plus, so forth and so on. Lonnie was not a toy maker. He was actually an aerospace engineer for NASA, with a resume boasting a stint with the U.S. Air Force, work on the Galileo Jupiter probe and Mars Observer project, and more than 40 patents. Yes, he is also working on the Johnson Thermoelectric Energy Converter, JTEC, which converts heat directly into electricity. But it's the squirt gun that he created, which has given us all the most joy. Finally, Charles Drew. Every 2 seconds in this country, the United States, yet to be united, someone needs blood. Thanks to Charles Drew, that blood is available. Drew was a physician, surgeon, and medical researcher who worked with a team at Red Cross on groundbreaking discoveries around blood transfusions. In World War II, he played a major role in developing the first large-scale blood banks and blood plasma programs. He also invented the, and get ready now because this name is pretty charming, blood mobiles. Yes, that was his brainchild, the blood vehicles that you see coming into neighborhoods with the capability of being able to take blood, receive blood from volunteers. Charles Drew, a man of color. These are the refrigerated trucks that to this day safely transport stored blood to the location where it is needed most. Drew was one of the most prominent doctors working in his field and one of the only African Americans during a time when blood donation was still separated, watch it now, along the lines of race. Drew eventually resigned from his position with the American Red Cross over their insistence on adhering to this separation policy of people needing blood. It was 1950. This is amazing reading to me. It was 1950 before the Red Cross finally recognized all blood as being equal. Now, as if people in their quest for equality between the ethnic groups was not enough. The bevy of that, the bearing really came, the underpinning came from the fact that white people did not believe that black blood was equal, of value, able to do the same thing in the human anatomy. So it was a complete circle of ignorance. Not only was the layers of melanin a difference maker in terms of black skin or bronze skin or brown skin from being equal to that of its white counterpart's skin, but now inside of that thought was the idea that not even the blood was of the same quality. Now, this is amazing. When you understood, now again, 1950 was when it was recognized that all blood, all other things being equal, relative to the types of blood, was equal. It was 1950. So that's what, 71 years ago? 71 short years ago. So just think of how many people died needlessly over this racial issue that you had a man right there with the idea, with the answer, but they died because of a refusal to receive black, bronze, or brown blood, as it were. Let's get back to these non-barking dogs. Now, I didn't coin this phrase. It really is taken from a passage of scripture. Under the Old Covenant, in the Old Testament, when Israel, who was taken into captivity, extracted from their homeland in Jerusalem, and taken captive by the Babylonians, then the Assyrians, and there's one other group, I think, that took them into captivity. Won't get into Bible history on a large level. But every time they were taken into captivity, in other words, every time they were not free, and this is significant for tonight, every time God's people were not free, he would raise up a prophet, whether a major prophet or a minor prophet or a combination of the two, to bring a word from heaven to his people to get them back to where they should be. Uplift, which was the real mantra of the civil rights movement here in this country. Isaiah chapter 56, verse 10. His, God's watchmen are blind. Now, this is God raising up the prophet, and the prophet gets word from God. In other words, we could preface this by saying, and God said, his watchmen, spiritual leaders, are blind. Now, what good is a blind spiritual leader? They're all, not some of them, not just a random few. No, no. They are all ignorant, not aware of or abreast of the facts. They are all dumb dogs. Now, this is God talking about or describing the lack of character of his spiritual leaders. They're all dumb dogs. They cannot bark. They're theological terms for this, but we won't get into that now. They cannot bark. Sleeping, lying down, loving to slumber. Verse 11, yea, they are greedy dogs, leaders, God's leaders, whom he has raised up and placed in his body for the centralization of moving his people onward and forward, regardless of race. But he says they're greedy dogs, which can never have enough. In other words, they're never satisfied. We saw that in this last election cycle where we've seen spiritual leaders. Remember, it was the year 2020 for perfect vision, seeing people for who they truly are in their heart, their thoughts, their deepest harbored thoughts. They are shepherds. And again, these are spiritual leaders within the body of Christ or God's family that cannot understand. They all look their own way. And last year, we learned muchly that was the way of supremacy. That's really what it has come down to. They all look to their own way. Everyone for his gain from his quarter or from his position of stabilization. Barking again is emblematic or metaphorical of sounds indicating erroneous occurrences. So when something goes wrong, the attack dog is designed and trained to bark as an alert that something has shifted. Something is not as it is designed or has been or was designed to go. These dogs, proverbial dogs in the proverbial sense, otherwise leaders of God's people, seemingly because of their gifting, feel that they can influence the heart of God. This is called privilege. When you think that because of the office in which you have been placed, you are no longer responsible to the giver of the gift, to the caller of the called, but you use your position, your influence, and the way you have thought outside of God's call to influence the caller. Remember last week we talked about the delicate tension between Jeremiah chapter 18, the potter and the clay. Don't become confused. God is the potter. Humans, regardless of the hue of their skin, are the clay. So racism, let's get into it. Racism is a system. That is so clear to me now. It is a system. This is why it becomes very important that we have the right posture in dealing with whether people are in the category of the ignorant or the stupid, conscientiously, sincerely ignorant or conscientiously stupid. Whatever the case may be, we have to maintain a certain disposition of being able to teach so that people can gain the concepts being taught and shared. Racism, I'm going to get into it in just a few moments' time, but please hear this. If you haven't stopped what you're doing, if you haven't taken an opportunity to share, please like and share over on YouTube. Copy the link, YouTubers, and share it with a couple of people. If you're over on Facebook, press the share icon and like and share. Make some type of interaction as far as the chat comment section is concerned. Please, that really helps us. And if you're over on YouTube, randomly just type in my name, go to The Silence of Our Friend and subscribe. And please then also subscribe to our ministry channel. You'll pick that up and it costs you nothing, but it really helps us get the word out. Racism is a system. And here's what here's how I want to couch this tonight. Racism, and I'm going to give you several hues of definitions. White power over white powerlessness. Concerning the control of the browning of this country. I believe that's the birthing channel from which racism is born. I believe it has always, and even in the church, even amongst good people who are sincere yet ignorant, who are conscientious yet stupid, and stupid or ignorant to this point. Racism is a mindset of control of the white element. It has to do with the powerlessness of controlling the browning element. You see, the reality is, and we talk about the white culture being the majority class, being the majority culture in these yet to be United States. The reality is, as quiet as it's kept, draw in, lean in, come on, lean in. White skin, as far as the globe is concerned, as far as this third rock away from the sun, that's the earth, white skin only represents about one tenth of the continent's peoples. Not just the United States, but just in a larger scale. Now you think about that. People have known forever that white skin, even though in America it's called that class or that ethnic group is referred to as the superior class in some senses and the majority class in other senses. I think sometimes superiority and majority go together in some people's minds. They're complements. But the reality is 90%, wait for this, 90% of the rest of the earth's peoples are dark or brown skinned people. 90%. So it's my contention, and I suspect this has always been the mentality, that white people have been concerned. Remember, back in the days of racial segregation, Jim Crowism in the South, here in these yet to be United States, you would see signs often, and you would hear the Ku Klux Klan, Klansmen, and other anti-Negro then groups speak of maintaining the pure white race. You heard it all the way back 1700s, 1800s. You heard this with the neo-Nazis. This is the new level of Nazis who are followers of the Adolf Hitler mentality, the fascist that he was. But it's the mindset that there's this pure white blood, white race that needs to be preserved, because if you're only 10% of the Earth's population, and that means that there are 90% of others who are not, if you breed these numbers, and it's so hypocritical because that was the mindset, because if you take 90% and interbreed it with 10%, after a while, the 10% is gone. Yet, during slavery, white slave masters took black women on a regular basis. I'm not a light-skinned person at all, if you can tell. But yet Africans didn't look even my complexion. Africans looked maybe one up from my shirt. Okay, so how did we get these variations of almost light, bright, almost white within some who are even able to pass, quote unquote, as whites who were actually Africans in America? How did we get that? Well, it was the impure breeding, if you will, the rape, the misogyny and misogynistic attitudes of the white slave masters, as they just took black women, black slaves, and had their way with them. And the consequence was light-skinned people. So how could you have the mindset that you wanted to preserve the purity of the white race, but yet you were pleasuring yourself with black women the whole time that slavery existed? So it is this hypocritical mindset that racism is this white power over this powerlessness of white people to control the browning of the country and of the, yea, even the world. Now, this is not the first time this has come on into play. Remember, it's Solomon who gives to Israel and to us, secondly, God's wisdom. And in the book of Ecclesiastes, he says there's nothing new under the sun. Everything that is, was. Everything that will be has been, my words. Exodus chapter 1, verse 5. Now, I'm going to read this through just so you can hear it. I'm not attempting to preach a message, but I do want you to gain concept of where we're going. Racism was in the Bible. This is why I'm coming to you from this context every week. Exodus chapter 1, verse 5. And all the souls that came out of the loins of Jacob were 70 souls, for Joseph was in Egypt already. So Joseph was sold into slavery by his brothers, who were envious of the dream or the vision for his future, which God had given him. He's already there. God has raised him up. And because there's a famine in Israel now, Jacob, who is on the scene now of the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, now here we are, Jacob. And he's taken this small retinue of people. There are only 70 souls that have come from Abraham, Abraham's loins, making up this new Hebrew nation. Okay, so now we have 70 souls, for Joseph was in Egypt already. And Joseph died, and all his brethren of that generation, the ones who sold to, who were responsible for Joseph being there. And the children of Israel, again, this nation now, were fruitful and increased abundantly and multiplied and waxed exceedingly mighty. Sounds familiar to me. And the land was filled with them. So now you have one ethnic group who comes in to another country by way of a famine that they're experiencing in their homeland. And because they're there, and while they're there, they begin to grow exceedingly. They begin really to outnumber the people of the homeland, in this case, the Egyptians. And then it is noted that they are mighty. The land was filled with them. Now there arose up a new king over Egypt, a Pharaoh, which knew not Joseph, And he said unto his people, behold, the people of the children of Israel are, watch it, mightier, more and mightier than we. Come on, let us deal wisely with them. Racism, racist mentality, supremacist mindset. Here it is in the scripture. Let us deal wisely with them. It's a mindset. Lest they multiply. Here it is. Here's the fear. And it come to pass that when there falleth out any war, they join also with our enemies and fight against us. So get them up out of the land. Verse 11. Therefore, the Egyptians set the Israelites, the Israelitish people, over them taskmasters. That will be the equivalent in black slavery here in these yet to be United States of plantation owners, slave masters, to afflict them with their burdens. And they built these refugees, these slaves, the Israelitish people. Here's how mighty they were. They built for them, the Egyptians, treasure cities, Python and Ramses. And if you're historical at all, you understand these are the cities that are named for the more notable pharaohs of Egypt. But the more so in the seven wonders, eight wonders maybe of the world, one of them is has to do with the wonders of the world. Amazing facts, things that were accomplished in the world are the pyramids of Egypt, built by, wait for it, black, bronze, and brown people. Now, I'm going to spend a little time with this, but hold on. But the more they, the Egyptians, afflicted them over this racial issue, the Israelites, the more the Israelites multiplied and grew. And they were grieved because the Egyptians ethnically were grieved because of this other ethnic group, the children of Israel. And the Egyptians, one ethnic group, made the children of Israel to serve with rigor. Okay, so this is tension between the racial groups. And they made their lives bitter with hard bondage in mortar and in brick and in all manner of service in the field. All their service wherein they made them serve was with rigor. Everything mirrors what we have seen and understood historically about the plight of black, bronze, and brown person in America as it relates to the period we refer to as slavery. And the king of Egypt, the Pharaoh, spake to the Hebrew midwives, of which the name of the one, and the Bible records this so you will understand this is an actual event, the name of the one was Shiphrah, and the name of the other one was Puah. And he said, when you do the office of a midwife to the Hebrew women, and see them upon the stools, regarding the birthing stools, if it be a male or a son, then you shall kill him. But if it be a daughter, then she shall live. So the mindset to control this browning of this country, Egypt, with these brown people, which came from Israel or Jerusalem, which I'm going to drop some science on you in just a minute now, were maybe not black people, but they were brown people. The Egyptians are now afraid that this browning by way of the empirical, the numbers was going to affect their power. So this, they were powerless to control it because of the numbers. So they said, let's enslave them and make it based on race, which is the idea of racism. Now, the Bible is clear that the people, country, and nations in the Bible, wait for it, for the people in the back of the room who will not want to hear this. And this is what I love about the electronic media and the electronic platforms. They'll be around forever. So you'll not be able to do anything with this unless I decide to take it down. And that's not getting ready to happen anytime soon. The Bible is clear that the people, countries, and nations in the Bible belonged to Africa and Africans, not Europe and Europeans. Now, I'm a churchman. I was raised in the church, but nobody ever told me this. And again, I'm prolonging the time, but I need you to get this. I need us to get this. No one took the time, because they probably didn't know, because that's what racism does. It invades the mental space of people. It's kind of like one of the reasons I don't allow music while I'm teaching. I'm fine with that. Hooping, you can't be a black preacher and really be effective in the black church and not know something about hooping. But moreover, I was raised Pentecostal holiness when Pentecostal wasn't cool. And if you couldn't hoop in the Pentecostal church, you washed up for the most part. But I'm mostly better at teaching, so I don't allow the music to play while I'm making a point. And the reason for that is that music has been used to deafen the hearing sensory impact. So when people don't want you to think, they play music. This is why the white culture has gathered and garnered so much of rap, which was started as that, and it's kind of deteriorated depending on whose mindset you listen to gangster rap. And they want it, and they buy the albums, they control the music, and then they sell it back to us and make a profit. And then our people are driving around listening to music, and it's super, super, super loud, because they know something. Loud music causes you, or reduces from you, your ability to think. You get caught up in the music and you don't think about the lyrics. Oh, excuse me, I didn't mean to say that, or did I? You get caught up in the beat and you're not thinking about what's happening around you in your environment. But we can't be silent anymore. Things have become very dire and grave. Historians, Flavius, Josephus, Celius, Plutarch, Tacitus, Eusebius and Diodorus confirm that the original Hebrew, that's right, the Hebrews of the Bible, were a group of Ethiopians and Egyptians, and were forced to leave Egypt and migrate with their caravans on foot to this land, which Canaan ruled, a land of Africans in northeastern Africa. This is the land of Africa where Abram lived for 10 years and married. You come to Genesis chapter 13 through 15. He marries Hagar. And the scripture is clear. The Egyptian. Where did he get her from? Because Egypt is where? In Africa. It was a walking distance from where he was. Let's go further. Eden in the Bible is in Africa. The scripture also shows where the Garden of Eden was placed by God. The scripture is clear. And why is it in there? So we could understand God's idea, God's mastery. There are some things in the scriptures that are not easily revealed. It is the glory of God to conceal a matter, and then it is the glory of kings, whom we are, to search the matter out. And this is why you need revealed ministers who are walking in revelation. Let's just steady ourselves here for a moment. The scripture shows that the Garden of Eden itself was planted in Eden, Africa, in the east, in Ethiopia, to be precise. As such, the garden is not Eden, Africa, not Eden, excuse me, Europe, but Eden, Africa. We also refer to the Bible and the world map to find out the names of the four rivers that flowed from Eden, Africa, to water the garden. Here it is. The four rivers in the Bible, Genesis chapter 2, verses 10 through 15, I cite this for a reference, were Pishon, P-I-S-H-O-N, the Nile, or the White Nile on the world map. The second river was Gihon, G-I-H-O-N, or the Blue Nile on the world map. The third river was Hiddekel, H-I-D-D-E-K-E-L, or the Tigris River on the world map. And finally, the Euphrates, both in the Bible and on the world map. These are all located in Africa. So we know that the Bible is a book of Africa. It's a book, and it's been documented so many places in time by artifacts, carbon 1421 dating, that the oldest civilizations were found in Africa. Let's just move away from that, and I'm going to bring that up possibly in another few moments. Our time is getting close. A glossary tonight, political slash politics. What does this word political or politics mean? Well, it's really simple. When you talk politics, when you talk anything that is of the political nature, you're talking about power relations between people, power relations between people. A system, then, what is the second glossary word is the word system, a regular method or order, a regular method, strategy or order, any formulated regular or special method or plan of procedure. It's just an order that people impose to get a higher achievement or accomplishment of things completed. It is a systematic approach. It has an end game. The system is not where you need to put your eyes. It's the end game that the system brings one to, or the end arrival. For example, slavery was a system. It was a physical boundary driven motion towards people of color here in these yet to be United States. But slavery also was emotional, it was mental. It was a system used to break into the control of the mind so that a system would be imposed, a system of control, a system of superiority, and a system of thinking, an encroachment on one's thought processes. It dictated the terms of thinking on its victims. And this is why the church should rise up and be the church, because when you give people truth, you liberate their thinking. And this is why I'm so at home and so comfortable, even with this podcast, because it's a venue by which you reverse perverted thoughts. White supremacy, for example, let's just use this as an example. Now, God never said any race of people was supreme over another. You will not find that in the whole, W-H-O-L-E, the entirety of the Bible. You'll never find that. God never imposed or insisted that one ethnic group was greater than another. But it is the end game of racism. The end game of racism is white superiority. So if you don't deal with it, I have a statement I want to make, and I might have to continue this next week. Here's a wonderful definition for the word racism. The belief, theory, or doctrine that white people are inherently superior to people from all other racial and ethnic groups, especially black people, and I include parenthetically bronze and browns, and are therefore rightfully the dominant group in any society. In his book, The United Independent Compensatory Code System Concept, sociologist Dr. Neely Fuller states, and this is imperative that we get this, and I would love it if you write this somewhere, that you can go to it immediately, put it in your notepad, in your device or something. Dr. Neely Fuller states, if you do not understand white supremacy, what it is and how it works, everything else that you think you understand will only confuse you. Might I say that again, share that again with us? Dr. Neely Fuller, sociologist, states, if you do not understand white supremacy, what it is and how it works, everything else that you think you understand will only confuse you. That is so powerful to me. It's profound, because it's a mental game. And if you don't understand the game, everything else that you think you understand, the inner workings that you think work for you, are only confusing. because as it's underpinning the foundation of the thought process is supremacy. This system is responsible for the racism in America. This system, by that I mean white supremacy. This system is responsible for the racism in America in and on levels from its inception. On slave plantations, you see it. In halls of justice, and I'll put that in quotation marks laughingly, you see it. Political fronts, you see it. Culturally, on every level. But worse than all that, you see white supremacy and racism in the church, the Lord's holy church, among these dogs who were supposed to be leaders to signal when things are off key and out of kilter by their bark. We've seen them bend in areas of white, the protection of white supremacy. Leaders whom God portrayed as dogs that do not bark. And I thought about this. If the dog won't bark, he probably won't bite when things go wrong. This included intentional illustrations in the church of a white Jesus. Thought that God was white. So that means that he had to be the insidious thought, covert thought that's associated with it. Not the overt. No one in the Sunday school class came out and said it. But when you show a white Jesus with white disciples and you're made to think that all the peoples of the Bible are in a white culture and all the miracles happen to white people and all the blessings come on white people, no one has to tell you. Your mindset bends towards this racist, controlled, dictated, without words, but innuendo thought that God must favor white people and he must hate black people. Consequently, they were fine with wrong actions toward black, bronze, and brown people because apparently it must have been the mindset of God. This had to happen to protect the idea and the notion of white supremacy. Even though the Bible and much of it originates from the continent of Africa. So here are a few results of racism, and I'll have to, wow. You had the Capitol coup just on the 6th of January, 2021, was a classic portrayal of white privilege and the protection of the system of racism. You had 5 people to die. You had a white police officer who was beat viciously, and none of the rioters were killed. If that had been some bronze, black, or brown people, man, we would still be burying bodies. They would not have been able to have the inauguration for the blood that was in the streets. Then the double talk of Mitch McConnell. Now, I'm going to play this. I think I'm right at my hour here. So let's just go to 2 clips. The one is from January the 19th. So let's play the first one. When he's commenting immediately or a week or so after, week and a half or so after the coup attempt to destroy the Capitol building. And then after that, I'll play for you his maybe about 2 minutes of his comments, of 20 minutes of his comments after he voted to exonerate former President Donald John Trump. Let's go to the first one. Cut away now.
Majority Leader.
The last time the Senate convened, we had just reclaimed the Capitol from violent criminals who tried to stop Congress from doing our duty. The mob was fed lies. They were provoked by the president and other powerful people. And they tried to use fear and violence to stop a specific proceeding of the first branch of the federal government, which they did not like. But we pressed on. We stood together and said an angry mob would not get veto power over the rule of law in our nation, not even for one night. There's There's no question. None. That President Trump is practically and morally responsible for provoking the events of the day. No question about it. The people who stormed this building believed they were acting on the wishes and instructions of their president. And having that belief was a foreseeable consequence of the growing crescendo of false statements, conspiracy theories, and reckless hyperbole, which the defeated president kept shouting into the largest megaphone on planet Earth. The issue is not only the president's intemperate language on January 6th. It is not just his endorsement of remarks in which an associate urged, quote, trial by combat. It was also the entire manufactured atmosphere of looming catastrophe, the increasingly wild myths about a reverse landslide election that was somehow being stolen, some secret coup by our now president. Now, I defended the president's right to bring any complaints to our legal system. The legal system spoke. The Electoral College spoke. As I stood up and said clearly at that time, the election was settled. It was over. But that just really opened a new chapter of even wilder, and more unfounded claims. The leader of the free world cannot spend weeks thundering that shadowy forces are stealing our country and then feign surprise when people believe him and do reckless things. Now, sadly, many politicians sometimes make overheated comments or use metaphors. We saw that unhinged listeners might take literally, but that was different. That's different from what we saw.
Another monitor that had me a little delayed there. I apologize. We're back. So here's the point. When racism is clearly involved in people's lives and enforced in their thinking, there are some byproducts. There are some things that happen as a result. Now, we had this capital coup attempt. And Mitch McConnell, in the first clip, says Trump provoked the Capitol attackers. This is we have Politico to thank for the research. He says the mob was fed lies. That's a direct quote. And this is by the author of the article, Andrew DeCedro, for January 19th, 2021. Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell on Tuesday of that week said President Donald John Trump provoked the rioters who stormed the Capitol earlier last month now, January, as Congress was certifying the presidential election results, his strongest condemnation yet, because he's been in the back pocket of the former president, of the outgoing president's actions that led to the violent insurrection targeting lawmakers. McConnell's remarks come as Senate is awaiting, at that time, formal transmission of the House's impeachment article passed last week, which charged Trump with willful, quote unquote, incitement of insurrection. So he is clear. Yet, this past Saturday, and we have CNN to thank for the clip. McConnell votes for acquittal, but then says there's no questions. You see the double talking you see the vast, outlandish, without regret, inequities between black, bronze, and brown people and white people in a racist system. And the church is expected to be quiet about this, because as it has gone, you've seen this in the last election cycle, as it has gone with church leaders, dumb dogs who do not bark. And if they don't bark, they definitely won't bite. We see the same parody, the same parallel, better, maybe a parody of sorts, emptying itself into the world system because the church has never given a clear picture of what things should be. So in a double forked tongue way, double talking way, McConnell votes for acquittal, but then says there's no question Trump is responsible for the riot. CNN published Saturday, February 13th, 5:04 p.m. Senate majority, and I just played a few minutes of it. It's about a 20-minute clip, and I know you didn't want to hear all of that. Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell, he's a Republican from Kentucky, as if you didn't know this already, said the former president is clearly to blame for the deadly Capitol riot. Minutes earlier, McConnell voted that Trump was not guilty of inciting the attack. And I quote, and here's another quote, there's no question that Trump is practically and morally responsible for provoking the events of that day, McConnell said, just after the Senate acquitted Trump. So this is a vestige. This is what happens when you have a racist society that has not been corrected by the invisible axis expected by God to bring correction, called the church and church leaders. You have double talking. You have signaling, you have dog whistling, and it becomes more and more outlandish and more uncovered and more boldly. You have the same man with the same set of circumstances. One day he says they're totally wrong, and the next day he comes back when it's time to vote as the majority leader, Republican majority leader of the Senate, then. And he says, yes, the man is wrong. Morally, he's wrong. And in every other way, but because he is white, they have other reasons, but because his skin is white, he will be exonerated, or has been exonerated from the charges, which we all saw lived out in real time. There's no question about it. The House managers provided an excellent case. The problem with a conviction is that you're attempting to override the mentality of white supremacy and racism in this country, and sadly in the church. I'll have to draw this in because I think my hour has come and gone. I'll ask you one question, and you all hit us back in the chat with your responses. There's one other piece, maybe because this is kind of hot off the presses, so to speak. A gentleman by the name of Austin Chenge, C-H-E-N-G-E, who is an African-American, who's a black man, who is running. He's a GOP, and we had that as a glossary term before, Grand Old Party / the Republican Party, okay, is a candidate for governor in the state of Michigan, who wants to cancel Black History Month. Now, this is a black man. See, these are the vestiges. This is what happens when you brainwash, when you redact, when you whitewash, when you lighten and whiten the facts. Even black people, brown people, bronze people begin to drink the Kool-Aid, as we put it, euphemistically. He says Black History Month is offensive, unfair, and probably illegal. And I quote, in the first couple of months of his campaign, Chenge has come under fire for some other things he said online, like that the rioters who stormed the U.S. Capitol were overcome with passion. Think of that now. Just amazing. Do I endorse it? He's asked. No, absolutely not. But what I'm saying is trying to understand why it happened and what led them to that point. These people who These are people who didn't go there planning to do this. They just simply went there to protest the way their country was headed. They have a right to do that. Now, somehow they got overwhelmed by passion. And that's a quote. This is a black man who's running for a governor of the state of Michigan. So I would like to ask him, okay, you want to move Black History Month off the calendar year because you say it's offensive, unfair, and probably illegal. You go on to say it causes division. You are taking away by celebrating Black History Month from all Americans. So that means you're going to attempt to delete the contributions of people who cut their teeth in the suffrage of building this country. You're going to rob them now of the opportunity to be represented for their own work and their own contribution to this country. What of then St. Patrick's Day? You going to take that off the calendar? What about Columbus Day? These are ethnic holidays. Ethnic celebrations certainly take place. What about Christmas? Christmas is a day that is not celebrated by all religions. It is celebrated by believers in the Son of God and his nativity, Jesus. That's not everyone. So now are you going to work backwards and take off every day out of the calendar that represents a certain segment of people in the calendar? See, these are the kinds of things that happen when we are not talking about and we're not providing a workable model for racism and white supremacy. Here's a question. I'll pick this up next week, so we'll have part five next week if you all are interested. How do we create strong, functional black, bronze, and brown people who emerge successfully from systematic racism? How do we redefine the roles and with intention create functional, not dysfunctional or misfunctional, but functional black, bronze, and brown people who emerge from the devastating effects, the chilling effects, long term, over 400 years of the effects? Now, we have a model in the scripture. It was Israel, these darker hued people who for 400 years were enslaved. These are the Jewish people now, not purely white people, but I promise you, they're not in the same condition that they were under Adolf Hitler's regime, nor are they in that same position as they were during the time of the 400 years when they were under the Egyptian bondage. I'll leave you with that. So how do we? So the scriptures give us some clues, and I want to ask you just as a sub point to that question, does it begin in the home? Remember, they said to control them, let's kill all the males and let the females live. What effect does that have in supremacy of a particular ethnic group? A B part to that same question. We'll come back next week. I'm wrapping it up. I promise you I'm finished. How can the immature, undisciplined, and uneducated produce a well-rounded people? If you have people that are at 12 and 13 and 14 years of age having children, the grandmother is only 30 and the great grandmother is only 42 and the mother is called Pam. The child doesn't call them mom because they're too close in age. So somehow there have been certain things that have been allowed to happen to black, bronze, and brown people because they know those things limit us, and the church has to become involved. We cannot be silent any longer. The final close here, business philosopher Jim Rohn says, sincerity is not a test of truth. We must not make this mistake. He's so sincere. He must be right. He's so sincere. It is possible to be sincerely wrong, We can only judge truth by truth and consequently sincerity by sincerity. Just as there is a time to keep silent, there is a time to speak. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 7, a time to keep silence and a time to speak. We cannot be silent anymore from our various platforms of influence. Silence is golden, some would sing. I say to them only until one's friends and families are negative. Friends and family are negatively affected by wrongdoing. Others would say silence is great for particular people. To them, I would say until someone's voice is necessary to save your life or corroborate your innocence. Silence, I go on for my Georgisms here. Silence is compromise. Silence is complicity with erroneous thinking. Silence is agreement with sanitized history. Silence is co-signing with control, racist, bigoted, and supremacy mentalities. Silence is equity and fairness in reverse. Silence robs supremacy of ever hearing truth and having the opportunity to change. Silence is the voice of continuous ethnic mistreatment. Silence validates inferior treatment. Silence is the approval of being objectified and maligned. Silence is often mistaken for agreement and consent. Silence is the devastation of a child being uncontrolled, untrained, and undisciplined by its silent parents. Silence is one level of maintaining and perpetuating cloaked ignorance. Silence is the ostrich syndrome. Liberty and justice end in silence. Until next week at 6:30 p.m. Central Standard Time, Monday evenings, And please visit our websites and visit the YouTube platform and to do what you can to make the channel grow. Till then, remember, we cannot ever be silent again. Blessings and peace.